Ubisoft set up a brand new studio, Ubisoft Berlin, earlier this year. However, the company has confirmed that the studio will begin developing games in 2018. And the first game that they'll develop? Well, it will be related to the Far Cry franchise, it seems. The studio will be managed by studio manager István Tuchné, who has worked with Ubisoft Blue Byte for a while now and has overseen the Anno brand for a bit. Whether or not the new game in the series will be a full-fledged Far Cry 6 after Far Cry 5 releases early next year, or a spin-off like Blood Dragon and Primal, is something that for now remains to be seen. Until we know for sure, we do have Far Cry 5 to look forward to. The new game in the franchise will be set in Midwestern America and will be available on February 27th, 2018 for PS4, Xbox One, and PC. Some of you may remember Siphon Filter, a stealth action game that was originally developed by Eidetic, which is now Sony's Bend Studio. This is the same studio working behind Days Gone. While Siphon Filter has not had much presence for a while now, users at Reset Era noticed, via Gematsu, that Sony had filed for a fresh trademark application for the game's name in Europe. A similar action was undertaken by Sony just before they had announced the remake of Shadow of the Colossus. This begs the question if the series will be making a comeback of some sort anytime soon. However, this move by Sony may just be a standard procedure and doesn't necessarily indicate that a new game is on the way. Siphon Filter had originally debuted on the PlayStation 1 back in 1999, and the last we saw of the series was in 2007, with Siphon Filter Logan's Shadow. It remains to be seen if another entry in the series is on the way. In the last few weeks, we've been receiving an increased number of reports on the progress of Death Stranding, including Hideo Kojima's work on the script and the fact that we might be getting a trailer for the game soon enough. And now it looks like there's more progress in that area. It's starting to look like Kojima Productions might be ready to reveal gameplay footage sooner rather than later. Guillermo del Toro, who's part of the game's cast, recently sat down with IGN to talk about the game. He was asked about his experience while working on the game, and he talked about how it's different from his work on the canceled Silent Hills, before going on to mention that he might get to see some gameplay footage thanks to Kojima soon enough. It's been great as a friendship, and it's been great as a learning experience, Del Toro said, while speaking of his working relationship with Hideo Kojima. In Death Stranding, I'm just a puppet. I don't know what he's going to make me do. He's supposedly going to show me the gameplay at some point in the next couple of weeks. The fact that Kojima is ready to show gameplay footage to Del Toro, of course, doesn't automatically mean that he's ready to show it to us, the fans, as well. But it does indicate that the game is far enough along in the development process. Could it be that we might also get to see a gameplay reveal at some point in the future? Possibly maybe even the year is out? Also, in slightly unrelated news, it also looks like Hideo Kojima might have a cameo appearance in Death Stranding as well. His personal assistant recently took to Twitter to post a picture of him surrounded by motion capture equipment, which leads to the assumption that he might be in his own game. It wouldn't be the first time either. Kojima famously cameoed in both Ground Zeroes and The Phantom Pain as well. Loot boxes are perhaps the most controversial form of monetization in gaming. They strip away content from games, sell it piecemeal while associating it with an RNG role, you literally pay money for a chance to win what you want, and throw game balance out of loop if implemented poorly. Look at Star Wars Battlefront 2. They're also facing significant resistance at the moment, again thanks to Star Wars Battlefront 2. That said, no matter how much one may hate loot boxes, and one really hates loot boxes, trust me on this, they might not be going away anytime soon. That's because they're simply making far too much money for that to happen. Speaking to Glixel, Lewis Ward, research director at IDC for gaming, VR, and AR, confirmed as much. The loot box system makes too much money for it to stop, but it's going to naturally be rightfully viewed as a cause of potential concern by gamers because it's a change and they don't know how it's going to work, Ward said. Games are really becoming services, where the launch of the game is just the beginning of monetization and the big money is having a large community, a large user base that keeps playing year after year after year. He may be right, but then it comes down to the question of balance and also of the kinds of games that implement them. Games that are multiplayer services? Sure, we can see some justification for their inclusion in those titles, especially if they offer content for free and the loot boxes subsidize that content, but in a single-player game or a game selling add-on DLC too? Yeah, not happening. Microsoft's new Xbox One X system was sold out in Japan as early as before launch day, but what wasn't so clear is what that actually meant. Microsoft's consoles have historically been all but ignored in Japan, with the Xbox One S even being advertised more for its media capabilities that, oh by the way, can also play video games. When word came out that Xbox One X pre-orders were sold out across the country, and that there would be no orders available for in-store pickup on day one, a few things could have been happening. Either the sheer power of the Xbox One X was catching the attention of the Japanese market, or it was a really low shipment. Keeping things limited would have made sense for Microsoft, seeing as they've never sold that well in the country, and now that the weekly media create charts have been released, we have the answer. They did limit the shipment to just pre-orders, selling a meager 1,344 units. This is behind even the Nintendo 2DS at 1,484 units, and hilariously behind the 79,958 units of the Nintendo Switch moved during the November 6th to November 12th period. A surge is a surge, however, and the Xbox One X has moved more units from Microsoft than other versions of the console have done in 3 months, according to previous MediaCreate data. Meanwhile, sales in North America are much bigger. The Game Awards are almost here, and for many, they're a more exciting event not for the actual awards, but for the new trailers and announcements that we always inevitably end up getting at the show. Over the last few years, the prominence of the game showcase at the event has only gone up. Everything from Mass Effect Andromeda, Mass Effect 3, Telltale's Guardians of the Galaxy, No Man's Sky, and so on got shown off at the event. So of course, with the Game Awards permanently established as a fixture of the gaming landscape at this point, all eyes are now on this year's event. What might be shown off this time around? According to Jeff Keighley, who runs these things, the unexpected. That's what he tweeted on Twitter before following it up with another tweet pretty explicitly confirming that at least one unannounced game will be shown off at the event. Which is interesting. What kind of things might we see at the show? Death Stranding, The Last of Us Part 2, Bloodborne 2, Metroid Prime 4, Retro's new IP, something else entirely perhaps. We're pretty excited to see what Keighley has in store this year. Cyberpunk 2077, the eagerly anticipated next game from CD Projekt Red and their first title since they found mainstream success with The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt in 2015, is currently still largely a mystery, owing in large part to the fact that ever since it was announced almost half a decade ago, we've seen nor heard much of it. However, there is now one thing we do know, which isn't necessarily the most encouraging thing to hear from a developer that you would otherwise turn to, hoping for quality single-player experiences. According to CD Projekt Red's CEO, Adam Kaczynski, the upcoming game will have online elements of some sort, which he confirmed in an interview with Strefa Inwestorow, a Polish investment site, which was translated by TechRaptor. Online is necessary or very recommended if you wish to achieve a long-term success. At some point, we have mentioned that there will be a certain online element related to Cyberpunk, he said, adding that there is great value to a well-done multiplayer mode. Multiplayer is strategically important. Playing online is strategically important because we want to have a commercial leg for service-type games. Games which generate stable income period to period, which are built. Of course, every game ends after a number of years. Some service-type games function even after 10 years. But outside our main source of income, meaning big names, it's building a stable source of income. And in the future, we can imagine a lot of connections between big games and service-type games. We have to acknowledge it, it is obvious. Even if this is a well-done games-as-a-service-style game, we're not sure we want CD Projekt Red to dilute their focus from strong single-player experiences. If Bethesda can sell 30 million copies of single-player experiences with no games-as-a-service elements, why can't CD Projekt Red? That'll be it for this video. If you like what we're doing, please go ahead and subscribe, and we'll see you next time.